All right, everyone, thanks so much for coming again. I'm going to open us with a word of prayer before we get into it, and I hope that it really is my prayer. I pray every single day for you guys as much as I can, faces and names that God will give you opportunities to share and that you'll follow through by His grace. So let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for today, another day to learn about you and serve you. God, it's always a blessing. We need to remember that each day and each opportunity is a blessing that you've given us. And so, Lord, would you teach us today, here and now, what it is we need to be better ambassadors for you, to represent you more fully and more powerfully. And I pray all this in your Son's name. Amen. So last week we covered testimony, word of our testimony, and that was all about how can I leverage my story to actually reveal the story of God to people. So it was basically how can I package my story, how the gospel transformed me to share the gospel with other people, and so that was last week. And what I thought would be helpful, although we switched orders, is to give us actual verses and things, you know, talk about the Word of God, plugging that into our testimony or any other form of sharing the gospel that we have. So that's what this week is going to be. And so, but we're going to start out with the more ideas, like, so why do we bother putting scripture in it? Why does this even matter? And what does that even look like? Because I think there are some misconceptions there. So topic overview. Here's our topic overview. Our testimony or any other presentation of the gospel is more powerful when it is infused with the Word of God. It's more powerful when it's infused with the Word of God. And so that's what we're going to talk about today, is we all want to be faithful witnesses. We want to be effective witnesses for Christ. And so any way we happen to be doing it, I believe, and I think the Bible is what makes me believe it, that it is more powerful when we infuse the Word of God. So why is this true? Why do I think it's true that it's more powerful to witness with the Word of God? Number one there in your notes, God gives faith, and that's the ability to trust Him, as His gospel is proclaimed. And we see that in Romans 10:17. It says there, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the Word of Christ. Faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the Word of Christ. I gave you guys my testimony last week. And that was part of my testimony, was for whatever reason, again, I kind of knew the gospel, like pieces of it, but I didn't understand it fully. And so there was a time when I was, you know, still, I was rebelling against God, but I knew I shouldn't be. And I'm like, well, what do I do? And then I still do remember, you know, different people, Travis specifically, Pastor Travis specifically, just explaining to me the gospel very clearly. And all of a sudden, light bulb. It's like, oh, that's what the gospel is? And God, through that, through the gospel, I was also reading my Bible myself, but through all these different avenues, what was giving me faith. He was enabling me to believe through the Word of Christ, through the Word of the gospel. And so you say, well, that's cool. That's the gospel proclaimed. But let's talk about actual scripture, using actual verses for witnessing. Number two. Scripture makes a person wise unto salvation. Scripture makes a person wise unto salvation. And the Bible, we saw in Romans chapter 1, we're not going to go and look back, but it talked about how our hearts and our minds were darkened because we had rejected God. We were fools. We were made fools. Thinking we had become wise, we actually became fools by rejecting God. And so we need something to now make us wise. And we see from the Bible that Scripture itself can make us wise unto salvation. Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3:15, he says, "You have been acquainted with the sacred writings," that would have been Old Testament Scripture, "which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus." So the sacred writings, the Word of God, Scripture, was able to make him wise through faith, wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. I mean, that's a pretty powerful understanding, that Scripture can do that. I would say this isn't what we're talking about today, but a really helpful thing to do when witnessing to someone is say, hey, you should read a book of the Bible, you know, and John is often what we tell people to read, the Gospel of John. But, you know, you could have them read Ephesians. You could have them read Romans. There would be a lot of crazy stuff that they wouldn't understand. But that's true for John, too. And why would you do that? Because Scripture is able to make someone wise unto salvation. I don't know. In church history, you have Martin Luther, the great reformer, I think 1500s. I could be wrong about that. 1400s, 1300s. It was before 15, I think, because... Was it 15? Yeah, because 1611 is KJV. Because I was going to say, anyway, so 1500s. So 1500s, you know, you have the Catholic Church, which was not only a religious authority, they were a governmental authority as well. So to go against them was a very bad thing. And Martin Luther was a man who so badly wanted salvation. He was a guy who, I mean, it is written that his, like, his leaders, you know, the I don't know what they'd be called, over him would just be like, dude, calm down. Like, the wrath of God is not going to reach out and hit you right now. But he wouldn't eat. He would flagellate, you know, whip and beat himself. He'd spend so much time on his knees and stuff because he was scraping so hard for God, but still never got this assurance that he actually had salvation. And he was right. He didn't have salvation because he understood the Roman Catholic teaching that salvation comes through these works. Yeah, Jesus paid for it, but you have to work in order to gain that. And so that was how Martin Luther understood things. Do you know what book of the Bible he was reading that converted him?
No, I was reading that he was a dramatic monk, and he was reading, I think, one of St.
Paul. Paul? Is Romans. Romans chapter 1, the dude sees the light. He goes to study and stuff, which all these things aren't in his language, so he's having to, you know, translate. And as he's studying through, he's just like... I think it was Romans 1:16, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. He's just like, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation, not my works. Don't quote me on that, although the video is going to quote me on that. But, you know, it was one of those verses where all of a sudden he's like, I think the Catholic Church is wrong. I think that their teaching is wrong, and that faith or that salvation is something that Jesus accomplishes 100%, and that he gives me 100% without any of my work other than believing in it. And that's not even a work, because God gives the faith, and it's the power of God unto salvation. And he saw that, and so Scripture was what made him wise unto salvation. Push people to read the Bible. Again, that's not our topic for today, but I think that's a helpful thing to have them read the Bible. God can use that. So we see that Scripture can make a person wise under salvation. And then number three, Scripture is profitable for their salvation. Don't put that. Don't write it. Sanctification. Scripture is profitable for their sanctification if they accept salvation. You all right? You want me to pat your back? Anyone? Okay. All right, so Scripture is profitable for their sanctification if they accept salvation. So you have some definitions. Justification was accomplished by Jesus, J, justification, J, Jesus, justification, Jesus. And then sanctification is something that is accomplished in us through the Spirit. So you have S, sanctification, Spirit. That's the ongoing work. After we are justified, we are then sanctified. We are made more like Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit and through the Word, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, Galatians 6 tells us. So, Scripture is profitable for their sanctification if they accept salvation. Why does that matter for us who are just evangelizing them? Why does that matter for us? I'll tell you why I think it matters. Because a lot of people say a lot of pithy sayings. I don't know. You know, a lot of quotes. Let go and let God, man. And they have just built their theology on a coffee mug, t-shirt quote, not on the Bible. And that's what happens, is they get veered off on their theology. I'm not saying that God isn't gracious and they don't have true salvation. I'm saying they got a rough road ahead of them because they got a lot of messed up theology as they get into salvation. Hallie was telling me a story on the way here. Her dad or her parents have a house that they're completely renovating. It's kind of like a craftsman-style house, and they're putting cedar shakes. Is that what it was? Yeah, cedar shake shingles on the house. And they have multiple contractors working for them, and one contractor went up to him and said at the very beginning, hey, those cedar shakes, those shingles are just slightly, what do you call it?
Crooked.
They're slightly crooked. And so her dad goes out there and looks at him. He's like, ah. No, I don't think it's a big deal. You're just particular, you're picky and stuff. And so, but she told me like that this happened. A guy walking by on the street, now that they've put them all up, walking by on the street is just standing there. Her mom comes out and's like, "Hey, how's it going?" I'm like, "Why are you just standing in front of my house?" He's like, "Do you know that your shakes are really, really crooked?" And she goes and looks at him, and lo and behold, what started out as a small deviation down here, by the time you get down here, has become very, very crooked. And so that's how it goes. You can also think of the compass. If your compass is 1 degree off, airplanes, 1 degree off, and you go flying in that direction, you are not going to get to the right place. And so we want to keep people with the truth. That is the whole idea of true. You know, anyways, it doesn't matter. True is straight, is what that word means. And so we want to keep people with the truth of God through Scripture. And so it helps for sanctification to not have to do all this damage control of like, oh, well, they just told me a bunch of their thoughts when I was getting converted, and this is what they told me. And anyways, so that's what we have. Scripture is profitable. Let's look at this. 2 Peter 1:19 through 21. Does anyone want to read that section for me? The 2 Peter 1. Loud and proud.
"And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts, knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit."
There's a lot that this verse does for us. But number one, it affirms that Scripture is true. Scripture is 100% true because you didn't have Paul just like doodling in his, you know, in a scroll. He was carried along, empowered by the Holy Spirit to write this Scripture perfectly, infallibly, perfectly truthfully. But also it said there, I like how it puts it, which you would do well to pay attention to. You do well to pay attention. Well, why? Why do I need to pay attention if I'm going to be sharing the gospel? And it says there, because Scripture doesn't come from someone's own interpretation. If all I'm sharing with people is my like interpretation of the world and God and stuff, I have a real good chance of giving them error. There's a lot there. But the next one we have there, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Anyone?
"All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work."
So we know this verse, these two verses. But we need to think about it, the application from us. Why would we not want to use Scripture? That the very, one of the main reasons God gave it to us is that it is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. We want to do that for people. We want to set them on a good, true track that we know is true because it's from God, not our own opinions, our own thoughts on religion, or any of these things. And so I believe that once again, from these verses and many others, that God's word, when we use it in our sharing of the gospel, I'm just going crazy right now. When we use it, it makes our testimony, our whatever kind of other gospel presentation we're giving them, that much more powerful. And but I want to say this. Oh, another thing I was thinking is a lot of times in the Bible, when you see Paul or Peter or any of these guys go to share the gospel to a crowd or something, they quote Scripture over and over and over. And that was actually in one of our sermons recently with Travis and Tony, that they use Scripture. They knew Scripture, so they use Scripture when they are teaching to make sure they're teaching the truth and that people are hearing the truth. But I want to make it plain to you that none of this means you can manipulate a conversion. There is no amount of Scripture, no perfect order. You know, we're going to go through the Romans Road here in a little bit. Okay, well, this is it. This will be the thing that makes them wise unto salvation. It will be profitable. It's not like that. This isn't an incantation, a spell that we're casting on them so that they magically get saved. It is still all about God giving the faith, you know, the Holy Spirit awakening them and them believing, you know, them trusting, giving their all. Repenting and turning from their old life and trusting in Him. All that still has to happen. This is just a wise way for us to share the gospel in a helpful way that we have our forebearers, the apostles, used as well, sharing scripture. So you might say, okay, so I need to share scripture. I got to memorize a lot of scripture now. And but if scripture is what has the power, do I have to do it word for word? You know, does my presentation of scripture as I share the gospel, does it have to be word for word? Well, if it has to be word for word, what version? What version is the most powerful? I mean, you get into some pretty hairy thoughts when you dig too deep in this. So I want to talk about it. I'm hoping you guys are somewhat acquainted with these things. But word for word, what version? Let me just say, first of all, number one, there is no inspired English translation. There is no inspired English translation. Which one do you think I was going to say?
Yeah,
Greek. Yeah, but I said English translation. So, and that's even despite the KJV only people who say, well, they were inspired, and they even have these things, well, they all got together and they all had the exact same translation. It's not true. When you actually look at the history of the King James Version, they had all sorts of things. They had some crazy, crazy things written in the KJV when it first came out that, like, is contradictory and just is loony. Like, you know, it might say, and he sat on the pillar. It's like, no, he sat on the chair, but they put pillar for some reason because they mistranslated it. And so later versions, which, by the way, like, they keep having to fix it, you know, if that doesn't show you that it's not divinely inspired, I don't know what is. But, you know, you'd have people who they'll say the 1611 translation, that is the one, that's the only one, God inspired it. No, it's just not true. But I just want us to be aware of that. So I put there, all translations are just that, translations of God's inspired word, which actually came in Hebrew, and then a teeny, teeny bit of Aramaic and Greek. So every translation that you have in the English is a translation. It is not the actual inspired, words written by Paul's hand. They're not there, the translation of those words written. I'm not telling you that they're not, I don't know, it's hard. You get messed up with words. Are they still inspired? Yes, they are, but they're not, I don't know. It's very difficult because he gave it to Paul and to Moses and to these different people in exactly the way he did. I want to say this, though. Some translations are actually a translation of a translation. Okay, so you'd have, like the NLT is a translation of I think it's like of the NASB. So they didn't actually go back to the original Greek and Hebrew. So that happens from time to time. And so that's worth looking into sometimes, because some are just translations of a translation rather than of the original. However, I put here, however, faithful translations are exceedingly accurate in all of God's word. So I'm just going to stop there for a second. Even though these aren't the actual Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic, these are exceedingly accurate. Like, we're talking up to the point, you know, like 99.999%, like that it is exceedingly accurate, that there is no question about what the original said. And they have all sorts of a science of figuring out any errors that may have come with scribes and all these things, and they constantly fix it. And that's why you see the different versions even get updated. Some, you know, every 5 years may get updated. And it's because they said, you know what? That word really doesn't work the best there. It actually looks like that was a scribal error, and this is better. Anyways, it's exceedingly accurate, and we even have ways of telling that. And they are entirely accurate in all foundational truths. We've never once had an error that we say, oh, wow, you know what? Salvation is actually by doing this and saying this. You know, there just aren't those changes. God still created the heavens and the earth. You know, we still sinned. And all the way down on the foundational truths, there's just no question about it. 100%, we know for sure we have it, because even everything is very, very accurate. So, what are translations? Translations simply fall on a continuum of literalness. So, some are more literal than others, directly from the Greek and Hebrew, for readability, understandability, and modern vernacular. What you'd have is some will use the old idioms even. I don't know any of the old idioms. I'm trying to think. Okay, so the Lord of hosts would be, some Bibles would say the Lord of hosts. And you say, I don't know what that means because we don't talk like that anymore. What is a host? I don't have a clue. But you look in the NLT and it will say the Lord of Heaven's armies. Okay, it's like, okay, the Lord of hosts, a host of this angelic army. That makes sense. But that's why, you know, you have the NLT, which is a more street version, slightly more. You know, it's not slang. It's not, you know, the cowboy Bible or anything. But, you know, so it helps you out on those things, because it's like, why would we know what Lord of Hosts means? You know, like, I'm sorry, I just don't know what that means. I grew up in East Brainerd, man. Like, I don't know what that means. you know, but you have from literal, you'd have like the NASB, that's the New American Standard Bible, the ESV, English Standard Version, then the NLT, then the Message. Those would go from very literal down to the Message is not even a translation, he calls it. He says it is actually just a paraphrase. So he takes chunks of the Bible, you know, maybe 8 verses at a time, and then puts that down in his own words. It's not even, you know, like you try to look up a verse and it's really difficult in the Message because they're not even listed necessarily in here's this verse and this verse, because it's a paraphrase of the basic idea of each section. So that's what you get. And it's all good. I'm not knocking any of those. There are some I would knock, by the way. I forgot that. The guys that come knocking on your door and have a Bible, I probably would not read that version in your daily devotions. They have changed things they don't like. They don't like that it actually calls Jesus God. You know, that there's, so they change the verses that you say, okay, that clearly shows us that Jesus was God. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Okay, so Jesus is God. He was the Word that was with God and was God. They change that. They say, no. They say like the and the doesn't matter. Articles like, you know, it was really, he's a God, not the God is what they would say. Anyways, which in the Greek, you do have to figure it out on those things because they're not there a lot of times. I'm telling you too much detail. So, what do we do? What do we do? You know, what version should I use? I'll give you a general rule of thumb here. Number 2, under that, we simply need to employ the word of Christ or the gospel contained in God's word in order to increase the power. So I put there, we need to employ the word of Christ. That's from Romans 10:17. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Okay, so we need that. Or the gospel, that's Romans 1:16. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. It is contained in God's word, but it's not necessarily word for word. So let's look at that. there are some occasions that we may recite, I put there, what did I put there? Anyway, this may happen as we recite or show passages to the unbeliever. So that may be that we say, hey, Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, or have fallen short, depending on what version. You know, we might do that. We might say, then Romans 6:23 says this, then this. You might even have your Bible out with them and say, look here at Romans 3:23, where it says this. And what I think that does is it adds credibility to what we're saying. Hey, this isn't my opinion, man. This is coming from God's word. Now, that may not mean much to them at the time, but faith comes from hearing. They may not believe it yet, but the more they see it, they see this the beauty of this book, that no other book contains this beauty, this type of good news. God persuades them. And Hallie was telling me about a good way that she was taught to do this. What you can do in these situations is, so say Romans 3:23 is going to be your first verse, or Romans 1:19-21, or just whatever is going to be your first verse when you talk to them. That's all you have to know if you do this. You say, okay, let me show you what the gospel is according to the Bible. I'm going to take you to Romans 1:19-21, and you read that to them. And then at the bottom of your page, you have the next verse reference written down. So it's like, okay, Romans 1:21. So I need to now go to Romans 3:23. Let me just go ahead and show you. And they don't even have to see it on the bottom of your page. Who cares if they do? But, you know, okay, Romans 3:23. Then at the bottom of your page, you have Romans 6:23 written down. So all you actually have to do is remember the very first reference. And then at the bottom of your page, it tells you what the next reference is to go through the entire Romans road, or to go through some other path that you give them. And that's the way she was taught to do it, with the Bible. So you can show them, this is not my opinion. The authority of God, his words, is what I want to show you the gospel is, which I think is very helpful because a lot of people have never even, like, you know, looked at the words in the Bible. Oh, that's in there? You know, all have sinned and fall short of glory. That's in there? I didn't, you know, I've heard of John 3:16. I don't know what it is, but I've seen it on a sign at a football game. You know, that's what a lot of people are working with. So you show them, like, oh, you think you need to work really hard, that your righteousness will save you? The wages of sin is death, man. Like, there's nothing you can do about that. You know, like, if you've committed one sin, you are no longer righteous. You know, and so, you know, you kind of can go through that showing them these things. But there are many times, that's your next point on there, we may paraphrase the truths contained in verses in a more natural way. This is more often probably what I do just because I don't always have this on me. I have my phone, which is a little more awkward to scroll through. But then just a lot of times I'm in a situation that the person does not necessarily want to sit down and see this. And I don't even necessarily want them to realize what I'm doing sometimes. And so once again, as I'm giving my testimony, I'm usually pretty close to saying the exact verse. And I realized that I, like everyone else, had sinned against God. I'd fallen short of his glory and what he wanted me to do, the way I wanted to live. Then I realized that the wages, what I had earned for my sin, was death. You know, and so I'm actually quoting verses to them, but they don't know that I'm quoting verses. So you can change it again to more modern vernacular. The wages for sin, you know, what I deserve for sin was death. You know, and so you're kind of translating it for them in a way that they don't have to have sat in church their whole life to know what you're talking about. And so I find that to be helpful. And that, again, has to be something God has to lead you. You know, I can't tell you when you should do that. But if the person, you know, is already going to be a very difficult one to talk to share the gospel, it may not be the one you want to bust out the Bible. They're going to be afraid you hit them over the head with it because that's maybe what they're used to, I guess. So that's what we see here, that scripture, as we infuse it in our gospel presentation, adds power because faith comes from hearing. Scripture makes us wise unto salvation, and it actually helps with sanctification on down the road so that they don't get way off the rails because it is profitable for teaching and doctrine and reproof and all those things. So what verses should I use? I'm honestly of a mind to say if you're clever enough, like maybe not clever, if you're creative enough, you could probably use most any verses you wanted to show how it fits in the story of redemption. But some of them may be less helpful. All scripture is equally divine and inspired, but not every verse is as helpful in each situation. A timely verse, you know, in the same, anyways. You know, you wouldn't say to someone who just lost their job, rejoice and be glad. You know, it's just like, well, that might be bad timing with that verse. You know, it's cool and it's true. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. Cast your cares upon him. So it's true that you should rejoice, but just wait on the timing on that a bit. So what verses can you use to share the gospel? A very popular one is the Romans Road. You guys see that there? The Romans Road, I have made my own adjustment. I know that that first one is long, Romans 1:19-21. But you guys know from the beginning for me that you don't know what sin is. You don't know what salvation is if you don't know who God is. Most Romans Roads start at Romans 3:23 for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But people say, well, what are you talking about? So I like to start with God. If they already have a background, a Christian background, you know, grew up in the church and things like that, you maybe can skip this first one because they'll already know, okay, God created earth. He has authority, yet we sinned against him. They get that. Does someone want to read Romans 1:19-21 for me? So this one gives who God is, that he's showing himself in creation as creator, it doesn't actually explicitly say that he's creator in this one. That's the only thing I don't like. But if he's made it plain to them in creation, I would say it's at least implicit that he's the creator. And he's shown these things so everyone is without excuse before God. They're without excuse because they should know who God is. They should trust him. And then it tells you, verse 21 tells you what sin is, by the way. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God. That's saying, I'm going to do what I want to do. You're not God. I'm not going to do that. Or give thanks to him. I'm not going to give thanks. God made everything good and perfect, guys. And yet we don't thank him. We live as though I deserve a good job because I work hard. You know, like this is all ways that we live like atheists, that we don't honor him as God and we don't give thanks to him. And what happened? But they became futile in their thinking and their foolish hearts were darkened. You can start there. And they might say, I don't know if that's me, man. Me and God, we got a good thing going. You know, I like to even sit out in creation, you know, and think about him and stuff. And I, you know, I pray every morning and stuff. You know, and so I don't really need this Christianity. Me and God have a thing going. And you say, well, that's cool. Second here, Romans 3:23. The problem is, man, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You've sinned. It's not just that you and God can have some relationship. How are you going to have that relationship? Like, you can't. You've sinned against him, which there are other verses you could use to show the separation. But we'll get there. You've sinned against him. You've fallen short of a standard. This authority God, you have fallen short of a standard. Then next, and you know what stinks about that is because you've sinned, the wages of sin is death. Romans 6:23, man. The wages of sin is death. I only give 6:23a because we're not ready for the good news yet. You can roll that however you want, but that's how I do it. For the wages of sin is death. It's like, well, that's pretty terrible, you know. And we'll get into this more, but it's like, but I'm not dead right now and I've sinned. That's weird. It's like, well, you're spiritually dead. You can tell. You're spiritually dead. You cannot communicate. You are separated from God because of your sin. The wages of your sin is spiritual death and eventually eternal death. Fourth, here's the good news, though. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Man, God knows that you've sinned against him. But you know what? He loves you anyways. And he sent Christ to die for you. In your sin. He's not waiting for a cleaned up version of you to then come and die for you. No, you were rebelling against him, and yet he died for you. That's how he shows his love for you. That's how loving God is. Then you can say the rest of Romans 6:23, and the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The free gift. You can go to this. It's like, well, what's this free gift look like? I added this one in too, so I don't know how helpful it'll be. What is that free gift? It says here, for if we've been united with him, that's Jesus, in a death like this, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like this. Again, that one may not be the best verse. I just kind of threw it in there. Because even if we're united with him in a death like this, they're going to be like, what are you talking about? Because they don't know, like, we're buried with him in baptism. It is no longer I who live, but Christ that lives within me and the life which I know. You know, they don't know that stuff. Yeah, but it may be helpful to show that eternity side. We'll be resurrected with him for eternity. And then you can show them this, even if you want to skip that 6:5 one. Romans 10:9. What do you need to do? What do you need to obtain that gift, that free gift of God? It says here, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. And they might say, what are you talking about? Jesus is Lord. Well, dude, he's the Lord of the universe. Like, he owns everything. Everything holds together by him. All things were made for him and through him. It's like, well, what's that talking about that you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead? Well, to pay for your sins, he actually had to die on the cross for your sins and take that punishment. But the fact is, he didn't stay dead. You know, if he were just a man, he'd have stayed dead. But it shows that he's God, that he was resurrected from the dead. You know, so you explain these things. And then Romans 10:13, you know, well, what will happen if I confess those things? Romans 10:13, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. You, sir or ma'am, can be saved if you would just believe in Jesus. You call on him as your one hope for eternity. You can have him. So that's the Romans road. You can look it up online, and you'll see all different versions using different verses and even different in-between things you can say to be helpful. But that's the Romans road. Again, either memorizing the verses you want to use or having them, you know, written in your Bible, like Hallie was telling me about. Those are ways you can do that. But I taught you the gospel, not necessarily in the Romans Road way, although we kind of went through it. But it's hard sometimes just to stick with Romans because there's a lot of good verses in the Bible that explain things. So I went ahead and put these in categories, some more verses, in categories. And so I did the God-man-Christ response, and then I did salvation at the end, just to say, like, what is so good about this salvation. But let me show you these. God. Here's a pretty good one. The way you could preface this, by the way, in your thinking, is who are we accountable to? You know, like, what's the big deal? Is there anyone I'm accountable to for my actions? So that's where you got Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Well, how can I know that? How can I know that I didn't just come out of some primordial soup, you know, and just evolved over time and became a human and I just make decisions? Well, I'll tell you how you can know that. Psalm 19:1 says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork." Look around, man. There is a God who created this place. This is, and you can go down those roads. This is way too complex. This is way too orderly. Why do we make, anyways, it doesn't matter. You can go down all those roads with just look around. You know, you say it more kind than that. But, you know, okay, and then they might say, okay, so he created me and everything. So what? Who cares that he created me and everything? Well, Exodus 23, this is actually the first of the Ten Commandments that God gave. You shall have no other gods before me. God is to be worshipped most in your life, the highest of everything. He is who your allegiance is to be to. Well, why should I worship him alone, you might ask? Well, Revelation 4:11 says, "Worthy are you, O our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." God is not just asking for our honor and glory to come to him. He deserves them. He is worthy. He is the only being worthy of these things. And so we're setting up who God is. God is worthy to be praised and to be glorified and to be thanked, you know, like going back to that Romans chapter 1 thing there. Well, what should that look like to honor God? What should that look like to do those things? Matthew 22:37-38 says, Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment." That's what it looks like to have him as God and no other. That's what it looks like to honor him and to give him this glory. What does that kind of love look like? You know, what does that look like? Leviticus 19:2. This one's kind of harder to use. "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy.'" That's echoed again in the New Testament as well. I maybe should have used the New Testament one for that. But you could just even stick with the "you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy." That's what it looks like to love him, is to obey his commands, to honor him and say, "You know what, I trust you, so I'm going to do what you say." Next, we move to man. So hopefully we've set a decent foundation for who God is. So this next one, you could preface with, we should have obeyed God's good plan because, you know, he created all things. He created them good. You could add those verses in that he created them good. We should have obeyed God's good plan, but as Isaiah 59:2 says, "Your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear." People say, "I get up and I pray every morning." He's hidden his face from you, man. Like, if you don't, you know, down the road, if you don't have Christ, then he's not even listening to you. So it's made a separation between you. And you think of that that model of, you have the gorge, you know, and where the sinner's over here, and then this gap called sin is there, and then God is over here, and the Christ fills that gap. That's kind of where that, you guys know what I'm talking about? That little, it's a tract that people use. That's what this is talking about. Your sin has made a separation between you and God, yet Christ has made a bridge across that separation. That's sort of what that verse is from. Well, what do you mean I've made a separation? What do you mean I've made a separation? Well, man, Isaiah 53:6 says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." That last part won't make sense because we're not to Christ yet. But all we like sheep have gone away. We've turned to our own way. Well, how have I gone astray? Back to our Romans 3:23. Well, all have sinned and we've fallen short of the glory of God. Anyway, so what's the big deal that I'm a sinner? Well, the wages of sin are death. We're kind of getting back into those ones. Why is it such a big deal that I've sinned against God? Well, the wages of sin are death. And as we said, they might say, well, I ain't dead yet, you know, and I already sinned, so nothing happened, you know. And you could say, well, Hebrews 9:27 says, and just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment. Well, you're going to die, man, and you're going to face judgment. And that's where you're really going to taste the death, the eternal death that comes because of the separation between you and God. There will be a judgment. Will judgment from God be a big deal? You know, they might, okay, God judges me. Lots of people judge me. Well, I walk down the street, they judge me. No, will that be a big deal? Matthew 10:28. Do not fear those who will kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. And that's like an eternal destruction. That's not a you're gone annihilation. Eternal destruction. Fear him. We tell people to fear him. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. That's right. People need to fear God. Fear having sinned against this great and awesome God. And we can do that through these verses, showing them, hey, here's how you've sinned. Next, Christ. And we could preface all these with saying, we've sinned against God, right? When you showed them those. Now, we've done those awful sins. We've made that separation. But John 3:16, not Austin 3:16, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Man, you sinned against God, but God loved you so much. Think about that. That's how you got to show these people. Remember grace? The something of salvation, or the something of gospel, the power of the gospel. I don't remember what that was, but that was a few weeks ago. We talked about how grace should flavor our whole presentation. Man, you've sinned, but God loves you so much that he sent his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Man, this God is so good. Luke 19:10 says that the Son of Man, that's Jesus, came to seek and to save the lost. Man, he came here to seek and save you. Romans 5:8, we already talked about this. God shows his love for us, and that while we're still sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 6:23, the second half, the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. 1 Peter 2:24, let me say this. Well, how is that free gift bought? How could God give me this free gift, man? I've done a lot of bad things. How could he possibly give me this gift? Well, 1 Peter 2:24 says, he himself, that's Jesus, bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds we've been healed. That first part, this is why I say the worst part of what happened to Jesus was not the nails through his hands. It wasn't the crown on his head. It wasn't the whips. It was the fact that he bore my sin. Remember, the wages of sin is death. Jesus bore the wages for my sin on himself. That was a spiritual torment that he received on the cross. Isaiah 53:5 says a similar thing. But he, Jesus, was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. That first part there, for Christ also suffered once for sins, that's more saying he only needed to suffer that one time because it was accomplished. He suffered once for sins so that, I don't know how to say that, but it's saying he only needed to suffer once. He won't continually suffer. He's not still suffering for our sins in that sense. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake, he, that's God the Father, made him, that's Jesus. So for our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Man, you think you're righteous. No, you're not. You need Jesus. But he gives you the righteousness you need because he took your sin and gives you his righteousness. That's 2 Corinthians 5:21. That's known as the great exchange. We exchange our sin for his righteousness. That's what we can tell them. So they might ask, or we can say, And there's no other way other than Christ, man. John 3:36 says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. That's awesome. You can believe in him. But whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Now, honestly, I'm going to go ahead and read a couple verses. They're not in order, and I'm going to omit them later under response. You could also add there John 14:6, which is under response. Is there another way? No, man. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Tell people that, please. Tell them that no one comes to the Father except through Jesus. And then Acts 4:12 is similar. It's right below John 14:6 on that next page, on your fourth page. It says, and there is salvation in no one else. There is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. There's no one else, guys, that we can have this salvation. We tell them that. You know, they might, well, I meditate. That's what I do. I meditate on a mat, and I feel really at one, you know, one with God and stuff. Man, if you're not coming through Christ, you're not coming to him at all. You're not coming to him at all. Well, Muslims, you know, they're really faithful. I mean, they're getting in planes and dying. You know, you don't see Christians doing that, you know, committing suicide. I'm sorry, their faith is in nothing. Their zeal is headed in the wrong direction, because without Christ, they do not have salvation. And so we tell them that. That's what Christ has done. He has made the one and only way unto salvation. All right. The next one we have here is response. We want to make sure that they don't just hear this good news, but they respond to this good news. Again, this isn't up to you or anything, or up to us. It's up to God and them. But we say, you know, because of what Jesus has done, John 3:3 says, man, this one's tough too. I wish I'd have omitted it. Anyways, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. The good news is, if one is born again, he can see the kingdom of God. And the reason this one is hard to use is like, well, how do I be born again? The same question Nicodemus asked. How am I supposed to be born again? Do I crawl back into my mother's womb? It's just like, no, dude, I think you're missing it. And here's what I would tell them. I do think this is important. It's why I kept it in there, is people think, okay, well, I'll just trust Jesus and we're good. No, they need to plead with Jesus. They need to beg him, make me born again. People see it as a decision when it's actually a new life. The old passes away, the new comes in our life. They need a changed heart. And see, they need to plead with God. I think that's important. Another thing on that one that I use is people say, no, well, dude, I prayed a prayer in junior camp, so I'm good. Or they say, I prayed a prayer and it didn't work. You know, I thought Jesus was going to change me. I thought these things were going to happen and it didn't work. And I say to them, man, unless you're born again, you're not truly saved. And so maybe that didn't happen. Maybe when you went forward or whatever, you weren't actually sincere. You know, maybe you just were afraid of hell, so you went forward, or, you know, whatever. And so I say, you need to be born again. That's why I left that one in there. It's good to remember that people actually need that. John 1:12. But to all who did receive Jesus, who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. People will say, well, I'm a child of God. I don't know how many times I've had that conversation. I'm a child of God. Well, in some sense, yes, you are, because you were created by God, and so everyone is a child of God. But there are those who he treats as sons and daughters, and there are those who he treats as rebels, and only those who believe on his name have the right to actually be children of God. In that sense, got the Romans 10:9 there again. Romans 10:13, another good one here. Matthew 11:28, man, tell them Jesus says this to you: come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Someone's all stressed out and freaking out, you know. I just don't know. Man, Jesus is trying to give you rest. I know you're heavy laden and you're weary. Jesus wants to give you rest. Respond to him. Accept him. And I'm going to skip John 14:6 and Acts 4:12 there. Luke 13:3. No, I tell you, but unless you repent, that's the other side of the coin of faith, right? We trust in God and we turn away from our old way of life. Unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. They need to know that. Your response includes more than praying a little prayer. It is actually turning away from your old rebellious lifestyle. Isaiah 55:7. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him to our God and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. God will pardon you, man, for whatever bad things you've done. Forsake you all the way. Turn away from those things. God wants to have compassion on you. 1 John 1, 8-9, this is a good one for the person who doesn't feel like they are all that bad. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Man, you don't think you've sinned? You don't think that you deserve this wages for sin? You're a liar. The truth isn't in you. That's kind of an awkward one to tell them. But here's the thing, though. Here's the good news, man. You don't have to keep hiding and acting like you're a good person. If you confess your sins, then he is faithful and just to forgive you your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Man, he'll do it. I didn't do that. Anyways, Isaiah 1:18. This one I should have switched to Christ. I don't know. I've got all these weird ordered. Isaiah 1:18. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Man, those are crazy words right there. The Lord says, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins are like scarlet, they will be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. Man, let's reason together. You can choose this. You know, this is what you tell him. God wants to reason with you. He offers that to you. Come to him and receive this cleansing, this forgiveness. 2 Corinthians 6:2. This is for if they're like, well, I'm going to think about it, which is okay. Let them think about it. But if they're putting it off forever, you might quote this one to them. For he says, I guess God says, for in a favorable time I have listened to you, and in a day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is a favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Man, you got all these problems in your life, and you've probably thrown up a few prayers. Oh, God, help me. God, help me. I'm listening, and you know what? Today is the day of salvation. I'm going to help you. Those prayers you've been throwing up, I was listening. Here you go, but you got to take it. Today is the day of salvation. Don't keep waiting. Revelation 3:20, that's that one. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. Man, this is an offer of relationship. Like this whole eating thing, you know? Like, man, God's knocking on the door of your heart. If he is, then let him in. He wants to have this relationship with you. He wants to get to know you and you him. He already knows you. Anyway, you can have this relationship. He's knocking on the door of your heart. In Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, we tell them again, you don't try to earn this thing. It's by grace you're saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. And that is what they need to do. They need to trust in Jesus, turn from their sin, accept that relationship. Then we can look at the next one, salvation. Here is why you should want salvation. Tell them this. Guys, these verses you need to write on your wall at home. I don't care. They're awesome verses that will pull you through the toughest times, the driest times in your relationship with Jesus. But teach other people these things. John 10:10, Jesus says, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I came, you know, Satan's trying to get you to go back into sin. You know, you're tempted with that right now. You know what he wants to do? He wants to steal your joy. He wants to kill you and destroy you. But here's what Jesus wants. He wants you to have life. He wants you to have it abundantly, not just some life that's boring. He wants you to have abundant life. You can know that. John 15:11. This is after Jesus saying, abide in me, follow my Father's commands. He says, John 15:11, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. Jesus says, this is the reason I give you commands. It's that my joy, a joy you know nothing about, by the way, you can tell people that. You don't know the type of joy that Jesus wants to give you. And not only that, that your joy can be full. Psalm 16:11. This is the God that we serve and we want to offer to other people. It says, you make known to me the path of life. This is what David was saying. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. That's the God that we get. That's the God that wants relationship with us. The God we rebelled against, right? But says, you know what? In my love, I will still send my son and I will save you. Trust in me and you can have my presence again. You can be at my right hand again. John 6:37. This is for like a well, you know, what if I get saved and then I screw up again? All that the Father gives me, Jesus says, will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. Look, man, salvation isn't going to make you perfect, but it will change you. And the beauty is Jesus will hold you. He will keep you saved. He will keep you. Yes, you'll fail, but you'll repent because Jesus will help you to repent. He'll never cast you out. 1 John 5:12-13. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. This is some comfort. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. They can know that they have it. Tell them that, man, you want to know that you have eternal life with God in the presence of fullness and of joy? Trust in Jesus. If you have the Son, you have life. John 5:24. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. That's the same idea there. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. By the way, you're not going to use all these verses, okay? Like, you pick them. I didn't say that at the beginning.
Every single one.
Yeah. Like, dude, we've been here 12 hours going through these. Romans 8:1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Man, that one's an awesome one right there. People have a moral compass. People have a conscience. Whether or not they have the Holy Spirit convicting them, they have a conscience. Push that on them. God, man, you have, I tell people this. Man, I know you go to bed and you're trying to sleep and you're laying there. And I know occasionally you think, man, I'm a bad person. What's going to happen to me? I tell people, I know that they think that. You know why I know that? Because the Bible tells us that people know in their heart that they have sinned. They know it. Whether or not they run to God, you know, that's a different thing. But I say, you know what? If you have Christ Jesus, there's no condemnation for you. That weight can be taken off of you and put on Jesus. And he will gladly take it and give you his righteousness. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You can go to sleep at night with the peace that you are right with God. So I tell people that. 2 Corinthians 5:17. This is what people have to look forward to. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. Man, your old life was terrible. You did a lot of wicked things. Guess what? God wants to give you a new life. A start over right here. Anyway, an easy button. You know, was that Staples commercials? Anyway, you know, it's a restart on your life. God wants to make you new, and you really can do it. I'm not telling you that everything will be perfect. You know, you won't be an alcoholic or a druggie or, you know, I'm not saying those things. It'll take work, but God will make you new. He'll give you the strength to do those things, and he'll give you a joy while you fight the battle and a hope and a peace that you've never known. You will be a new creation. I'll tell you one more that I use. And someone may know what psalm this is. I can't remember. Blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven, whose transgressions are not held against him. Does anyone know what that is? 55? Yeah, I'd be curious. I use that one for people who are embarrassed. I say, dude, you're embarrassed to come to Jesus, you know, all these things. Not embarrassed is the man whose sins are forgiven. Blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven. I just tell him, like, straight up, like, God is excited about forgiving your sins. Like, blessed is the man. That's what he says to you. Blessed are you. Happy are you is another translation for blessed. Joyous. This is a good thing to have your sins forgiven by a holy and righteous God, because Jesus already paid the price, you know. And no skin off his back, you know. Like, this is a good thing. And so I tell people that. I forgot to put that one in there. Blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven.
32:1.
We were both way off. I said 25. So you can write that down if you want. That I like to encourage people, like, dude, put your pride to the side for a moment. This is a blessed thing to have your sins forgiven.
And Romans 4:7 says the same thing.
Interesting. Yeah, quoting it. Okay. You're right. All from memory. Good job. I'm going to ask some more questions again. Has anyone gotten a chance to, you know, put any of these things in practice? I meant this week. Yeah. You have? How did that go?
It's funny because I did it twice in one day, and I was really bad the first time. But because I was bad, I started reading Radical by David Platt, and I was reading that just talking about this man who's trying to share the gospel and how by and he's trying to convert Muslims. So he started studying Muslims and how their faith worked and how he could share the gospel better for them.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, his faith started to grow. And his wife noticed this difference in it. And so I think most of it was from the day that I also was just reading and trying to, like, because my friend's opinion, and I don't think she knows it. She's really into all kinds of interesting things. But anyway, later that night, I have another friend who's messaging me and going through a hard time. And it was like, at that moment, I had all that knowledge from previously, and then it felt spirit-led instead
mm-hmm.
of just me awkwardly pushing it on them. But it was cool.
No, that's awesome. I like it. And there's definitely that difference there, too.
Yeah.
Prayer is 1 week that we'll talk about praying to these things. I feel like we should have maybe started with that. But anyways, that's super cool. That's great. Anyone else get a chance?
Yeah, I was asked to go to lunch with one of the consultants that we work with.
Mm-hmm.
He's out of Knoxville, and I didn't, you know, you talk with them you know, all the time, but you don't really know anything about them.
Right.
And so we're at lunch, and, you know, you always kind of, you're like, I want to pray for over my food, but you never know how someone's going to react to that.
Yeah.
And so I just did it. I just said, hey, I'm gonna pray over my food. And he was like ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when, that was kind of like, once I realized that he wanted to pray with me, I just prayed out loud for us both. And it was really cool because the rest of the conversation was kind of centered around Jesus.
That's crazy.
And it was a weird way of just doing what I always do, but it led to, I learned about where he goes to church. He's actually a Christian, so it worked really well. but I mean, I would have never known that, and the conversation would have never gone in that direction if I hadn't just been true to myself, you know, and done what I felt led to do.
Mm-hmm.
So.
That's awesome.
Yeah, like I was speaking with one lady this week and just talking about, I just talk about how God has worked in my life, and you know, it just comes natural just to talk about it. And whether she takes away anything from that or not, I don't know.
Right.
But it's just interjecting, you know, not pushing on her, just talking about how, you know, I deal with things and how I've dealt with things, and you know, that's kind of how I've gone about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this last time that I was talking to somebody, was just talking, just like talking to anybody, just about what's going on in my life with what God's doing.
Yeah, that's awesome.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
We've been just kind of making it our goal to pray over every single meal, and kind of hard when you have friends, whether they're believers or not, over.
Yeah, you feel a little weird.
Yeah, but it's kind of neat because even though, like, we've had friends who weren't believers at all, and, like, they'll still respectfully, you know, attempt it, and it's kind of nice. Just, even if it's just for you, I mean, they don't, I've never had anyone mind.
Yeah. You know, we have people that we eat with that they just expect it. Like, all right, Jeff, hurry up, pray so we can eat.
And one thing I would encourage y'all to do too, a guy who actually kind of taught me evangelism as well, as you know, went to an EB2
place. Yeah.
Like when you're at a restaurant or something, like you're obviously getting a host, the waitress or waiter, like ask them if there's anything you can pray for them for.
Mm-hmm.
And pray with the waiter or server right there at the table. And that's kind of a cool way to open up conversation with somebody. Restaurant, even.
That's great. Hallie and I have done that a number of times. It's a helpful one. I like it. She's gotten in some conversations too from it, for sure. Some of those things that have that some of their prayer requests are kind of funny. World peace, like kind of things.
Yeah.
Cool. We'll pray for it.
I do love her as an avenue toward the gospel, though. It really is one of those, I guess, opening things that you can use, like praying for your meal is just a you know, you can probably word it better, but an avenue
toward
talking about more things.
So. Bridge.
Yeah, bridge.
Yeah. And, I mean, I think, too, people, like, talking to God as though he is your father and your savior, you know, like, is people say, they know God like that? You know, it's kind of interesting. Reading, or I guess I was listening to an Audible book by a girl who was a Muslim and converted to Christianity and stuff. And she said she went over to some Christian's house and, like, the way they prayed, she's like, how dare they do this? Like, how dare they talk to God, like, in these ways type of thing. And anyways, but that ended up being one of these, like, huge draws. Like, but they know him. Like, you know, they know this God. So. Well, awesome. About out of time. I hope that's helpful to look through these verses. I love having a lot of these verses, even if they're just well understood, even if they're not memorized, to, again, paraphrase them to people. That's a new thing you can say. You know, your sin has made a separation between you and God. It turns out you're quoting Isaiah 59 or whatever that was. You know, just so reading through those and memorizing them would be awesome. Finding your favorite, you know, because we had talked about the gospel as God, man, Christ's response. If you find your favorites out of these categories, or your own favorites, they don't have to be on here, you know, and then start using those, memorize those that, you know, say, like, I feel like this one shows that God is the creator and that we are under his authority. I feel like this one shows it the best, so that's the one I'm going to hold on to. I feel like this one shows our sinfulness the best, you know, and so, or a handful on each, maybe, just like two on each. Or something. So it takes a little work, again, just like tailoring your testimony to share the gospel. Like, these things take a little bit of work, but it'll pay off.
Yeah, it was neat. The first part is just kind of like the Roman road, like what you would typically do. Mm-hmm. And then as you were going through, I don't know if you noticed, but you were just answering questions.
Mm-hmm.
I started writing down the questions.
Yeah, now I've got them all written in mine. I just didn't put them on yours.
Oh, okay.
I thought ahead, because otherwise that'd be really boring to hear me just read them out loud, which it probably already was.
Yeah, but it's neat, because that's, because you've had enough of those conversations, you're already answering a question before they have it.
Because you know that they have it. Whether or not they'd ask it, they have it.
Yeah.
Right. Well, cool. Does anyone want to pray us out today?
Dear Lord, we come before you, and we thank you for this time that we've had together to just hear your word spoken, and for the purpose of evangelism. And Lord, we ask that you just strengthen us as we go out, and strengthen us as we try to learn this and memorize these verses, or just memorize the concept, so that we can speak with confidence. And we ask that, with your Holy Spirit, Lord, that you would just encourage us and strengthen us. Give us that boldness to reach out to whoever you've called us, whoever you've put around us in our lives, Lord, that needs to hear these words. Lord, I pray that you would make us aware of it and give us that courage to step out in faith. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Thank you.